get ready for the fucking Hustle Season podcast.
Whoa. Coming in hot.
Okay. All right.
We got James Serenis.
That's right. Yeah.
We got episode 239.
Yeah.
James Serenis, Kelly Strawbridge, Reggie Pace.
Reggie Pace.
All up in here.
It's hot.
Hot too.
Hot day. Hot week.
Hot weekend.
Hot weekend.
Boiling hot.
Yeah. Anybody went out to the Dream Fest and
I almost said the Dreamville Fest.
Dreamville Fest.
Yeah, right. Daydream Fest.
There's been a lot of Dream Fest things happening. Yeah.
Yeah, the Daydream Fest of the past weekend was hot.
It's hot.
And it's shout hot out. Music.
Yes.
Hot temperatures.
Hot yeah. temperatures. Shout hot music. Pete. Shout out to Pete.
Shout out to Zavi.
Yep.
Yeah.
Prison Cat.
You did a good job putting that together.
I like seeing all the pics. I did not go. We had to do the we did the pool day hang yesterday with the kid
at the family
at the Granada
musician.
Oh,
is it the musician pool?
Hey, musician pool.
I need to hit them up because they owe me a.
You don't have to hit
membership.
Them at all. Just go.
Just
go,
show
just
up.
There. You just go and just tell them your last name and what you fucking did.
Well, they told. All right. Well, that's all
it.
Right.
Yeah.
It seems like it would be that easy though.
It is. And you know, some people like Bob's probably are there. You know,
yeah.
somebody's gonna be there.
No. Like I didn't need anyone to vouch for me. I didn't. They don't have anything happening, and it's just kids at the table. You just
well,
had, you
sounds
tell them.
Good.
Yeah, so it was
sounds
cool.
Sounds good. Time to cool off.
Yeah, it was very fun, but yeah, I forgot that the fest was popping off. But I'm glad you guys were there. You played.
I played a couple sets. And, shout outs to the Paramnaramas. Shout outs to Night Idea.
Dig.
You killed it. Both sets.
Hell yeah!
Absolute Destruction.
Again, shout out to Pete crazy. For sure for doing that. Mm-hmm. That's it's really, really cool to have a fest because we don't really have that many. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And it's independent.
Independent.
Independent. Unsullied with sponsorship.
That's right. Unsullied.
That's right. Clean.
You know, I hope everyone enjoyed our Steven Seagal focused episode last
Ooh,
week.
Yeah.
Mostly it was it, just
it was
the
educational
beginning.
Episode, honestly.
It was very
it was
educational.
Educational.
Well, yeah, that was
I was
saying,
say I've been learning a lot about Steven Seagal throughout the whole week. Now that my YouTube channel is nothing but Steven Seagal,
so mm-hmm. let me ask you a couple questions because okay. I had many as soon as you sent that because you have sent for weeks that you have been like in Steve Seagal land. You have been like
been
you
watching,
camped out
watching little movies about him and
okay. Stuff. And you've been listening to his whole
interviews?
Discography? Or
no,
okay.
I've been listening to interviews and stuff and okay. watching him. Basically,
but you were listening to the album, album heavily.
Oh, yes. I was listening to the album heavily.
Heavily.
The album all is the mind, tunes. It's mind-blowing.
It's all over the place.
And my album, it's like, what?
There's every time, no cohesiveness whatsoever.
No.
Every
no.
time a song starts, it's just as surprising.
Yeah.
And every time.
Yeah. And almost, it's not in a weird, bad way. Like, not like the Corey Feldman record where like the song starts and
genius.
We're like, what is happening? But this,
chaos.
It's almost surprising in a pleasant way where you're like, I didn't know Steven Seagal is actually like a little open minded to reggaeton.
He made an album like any
shit.
Pop star would. Like if you replace Steven Seagal with some pop star, that's what they would do, right? You got the reggae, you got this other kind of beat,
you got the blues stuff.
Somebody
blah, blah, blah.
Wrote a bunch of music for them and they just picked it. You know, out of
hot takes. Yeah. Hot take: Steven Seagal didn't write all this music.
Nope.
He didn't write all this music because the writers on there does not say Seagal.
No. There's. I think.
He wrote
I the reggae. I think the reggaeton stuff. He didn't write that.
Pretty kitty.
He definitely wrote that part. He definitely wrote that.
Make me comb. Make her comb. Oh man.
Oh, there's some cringy stuff on there. I mean, So what made you? What made you camp out in
Steven Seagal?
In Steven Seagal land? What?
Because he's a fascinating person. He's nice. Also like, he's really full of shit.
Right.
A lot.
Yeah, that's the vibe.
Yeah, like there's nobody can get really a straight story on his upbringing and stuff like
training.
He said he painted this picture of like his childhood being kind of like. He was always a badass and stuff. And then some interview with his mom, she's like, he was a sickly kid until he was about 12 and all this and that.
Okay.
He also has this, for some reason, he hates every other action star there is.
Yes.
Oh, so like Van Damme in particular.
Specifically him.
Yeah, specifically him.
Because they were...
Like, I'm the white karate man.
Yeah.
How are you going to be the white karate man?
He was on Arsenio one time and basically said, he goes, you know, Arsenio says, well, what do you think about Van Damme? He goes, Van Damme.
Van Damme.
Because what do you think about Van Damme? He's you know, it's they say he's a champion of, you know, whatever martial arts. He goes, he's like, that's a matter of opinion.
And he, like, stares at Arsenio for, like, a long time.
And he goes, can we change the subject?
It gets uncomfortable. It's But I will say, he was a different guy when he was thinner. Like, when he was a thinner dude back in the day before he got, like, really big and, like, Fu Manchu-like, he was, he had a smoother look that made you think.
But he never had a chance. He wasn't doing splits
and then,
for the ladies.
Well, see, then this is the thing.
John Van Damme is doing splits in his underwear and, like, he is wilding.
But, I mean, I'm saying that there was, like, Van Damme was, Van Damme was like Vanilla Ice.
No,
you know what I mean?
No.
He was the Vanilla Ice.
No. He's the Beastie Boys. He gets to be the Beastie Boys. He was cool.
You're giving him the Beastie Boys?
Who you want to give it to? Chuck Norris?
Steven Seagal.
I'm giving it to Chuck Norris before I'm giving
Chuck
it to
Norris
either of them.
Chuck Norris is the Eminem Chuck Norris. of white martial arts people.
Chuck Norris is Eminem?
No. Chuck Norris would have to be... you know, third base. He'd have to be. It's a classic hip hop.
Well, I feel like
you gotta be older and old. You gotta go older.
He's KRS-One.
He's old. The oldest white rapper would be.
He's Schooly D.
Yeah,
we're all over the map with this. I don't like that at all. I don't like any of
Van Damme was always his movies were just so much better. Like
But Out of Time was fire.
But also
Steven Seagal.
Steven Seagal didn't stay in the lane. In the way he could have. Well, he started to be, like, shooting people all the time.
Well,
and,
also,
like,
he didn't stay in the shape. His antics off the screen, he was just a dick to work with. He would also do shit like actually punch and kick for real the stuntmen.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So stuntmen would get, like, injured for real all the time.
He's like, Jackie Chan stuntmen get hurt. They did that. They know what they were doing, though.
Yeah, no, Jackie Chan would, like, really choreograph those
moves.
He
knew what he was doing.
He knew what he was doing.
Steven Seagal is also, like, on record, the worst guest host they've ever had on SNL.
Oh, is he?
Didn't want to do a sketch with Hans and Franz because the week before they said one of them said they could beat up Steven Seagal as a joke.
I bet he hated Arnold though.
He hates everybody.
He hates everyone.
Of those guys, he thought they stole his lane, right? Commando.
Yeah, well, he also thinks that he's the only one that's authentic.
He just thinks he's so self. Crazy. His self importance is just on
and
another
then,
level.
Then
that, you know.
He got into that fucking lane. Tai Chi shit or whatever it is, where you're supposed to use the people. It's like Mr. Miyagi stuff.
Yeah.
But
those
like
videos are hilarious.
And it's fat Steven Seagal just going, and
he has a look on his face
blocks.
Like he's over it.
He's
like, well, here we go again. I have to teach these kids about.
Yeah,
but like he never had a chance in the Karate Man world. He was always Charles Bronson, shoot 'em up kind of world. I thought his movies, you know, Under Siege.
Under Siege was kind of fire.
I thought Under Siege was great.
Yeah, those first couple were like good. And then for some reason, he just started going downhill right away. He couldn't really keep up. He got more Hollywood.
Those movies were just all bad.
True.
They sucked. It was, and like, he didn't have the charm of like dancing.
Yeah.
Or something like, you know, Van Damme is dancing.
He's still making movies, too. Like, he had this one movie where he's some hardcore, like, sniper master.
I tried to watch this on Hulu.
And he is real fat.
He's super fat. He does, like, a MAGA rant in, like, the first scene in the movie. It's like, people want to talk about what I can and can't do.
The
fake news. Here they come. The same tone, too.
Yeah.
And then people said that are going at it. Like,
wow.
He's a total dick.
Wow.
And that's it.
So you just find it fascinating that...
It's just fascinating that he has stayed in the public eye this long.
Right.
And is pissed off. So, like, no one has anything nice to say about him.
Nobody.
Like, at first it was just like, oh, it's just a martial arts thing. And then you dig a little deeper and you find out, like, every woman that's ever worked with him was like, yo, that dude tried to fuck me in the hotel room, like, to do, like, line reads and something like that. Like, he's like, that dude.
Everything you can think of.
Every negative thing, man. And the blues guitar playing where it's
that's
just...
That's in the pocket. of being a blues man also.
Yeah.
He's a total fucking loser.
Complete
blues
dick.
Man. Yeah.
Yeah. Dad blues. Journeyman, Rolling Stone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, that's so whack.
He's an expert on everything.
He definitely is.
He has that vibe. No matter what you talk about, he's going to be like, oh, yeah, I've done that for 30 years.
Lying.
Well, he's playing festivals like this summer. He's still mostly.
Oh, we should check him out.
He's still doing the blues circuit.
I mean, if he wasn't bullshitting, he would go ahead and try to get in shape and then do some celebrity fight with Van Damme. I bet Van Damme would do it right
Van
now.
Van Damme is... Okay, so at one point in time, there was a group of 12 fighters that all wanted to fight Steven Seagal. Uh-huh. They're like, you said you could beat up all of us at different times, so let's organize this.
Yeah, we will fight you.
That and could be the
that
plot.
That didn't happen.
That's a movie.
That could be the plot of the next Expendables or whatever the fuck.
Beat up Steven Seagal?
Just like the Steven Seagal would be the enemy. And, like, it's all those cats. You know, Norris.
Van Damme you know, in interviews says, you know, I don't have a problem with Steven Seagal, but he seems not like me.
He has no problems with anyone.
He does not even talk to this dude.
He goes, I like Steven Seagal, what he does. I think he needs to lose some weight.
Right. That's what everyone feels. Everyone's concerned,
so he
really.
Move better.
Then he dropped into a split during
yeah,
the
interview. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I will say, I mean, Van Damme's dancing, not that great.
It's horrible, but he was having fun.
Doesn't he sell Doritos now or something?
I think he's just chilling.
He's chilling.
He's in some Super Bowl commercial.
He may have been in one.
Yeah. He's mad rich.
He's mad
good.
Rich. And yeah. And he also had that movie he made as an older man,
yeah.
JCVD, in which he takes the piss out of him. You know, like he's not taking himself seriously. Mm-hmm. What if I was a normal guy that ended up in a crazy situation? If you haven't seen JCVD, go see that movie. It's amazing.
And again, I think he was in the Expendables too.
Yeah,
he was in the third one.
Yeah, he was a
villain. Yeah, because Van Damme plays nice with others.
They like him.
He's hireable.
He can act.
That's a big one.
He can still act.
He's hireable. He's in great shape. Again, speaking of action stars, let's talk about Tom Cruise a little bit.
The Michael Jordan of action movies.
The Michael Jordan of action movies.
You heard it here first.
You know, I'm fascinated, as much as you are about Steven Seagal, I am fascinated by Tom Cruise because he is one of the world's biggest actors. He, this past weekend, came out with the Top Gun sequel that is supposedly, I couldn't believe it, that this is his biggest movie opening ever. He's never cracked 100 million before on an opening weekend, which I'm surprised.
Yeah,
I thought the Mission Impossibles had done that already. Mm-hmm. But so this came out. It's a huge success. It was 97% Rotten Tomatoes.
They like it too?
Everyone liked it.
I was going to see it anyway.
But the reviews for this movie were off the chain. Val Kilmer is in the movie.
Can't wait.
They used AI technology to get his voice to work.
Okay.
Because he's got cancer.
He lost his voice.
He lost his voice.
Yeah.
He has a really aggressive cancer.
So they went and took old movie footage of him and AI'd his lines together?
His lines and I think his voice.
Wow. And they kind of like mixed it in.
It all together.
That's
and
technology.
Shit. Wow. The technology for this, they made Tom Cruise look younger.
They're
in
doing
this
some
movie.
Wild shit. I mean,
he looks good in this movie.
Yeah, he does.
Speaking of actors doing victory laps, when I saw that most recent Nick Cage movie, I was telling y'all just the same shit. They AI'd an older, a younger version
Nick Cage,
from another movie into the new movie with new lines. You know?
Look,
pretty weird.
Pretty soon we aren't going to have to use as many actors.
They're not going to have no actors, no musicians, no nothing.
It'll be like five actors.
We'll all just be watching
work.
Stuff.
I just feel
watching
like
and clicking.
You know, he's pretty much turned into the he's kind of brought the action star back a little bit, like as being the regular guy action star.
In my opinion, there's not that many movie stars in that way.
Well, I agree.
Left, period.
I agree.
You know,
no,
you're talking about him. You're talking about Tom Cruise. Tom Hanks.
Tom Hanks.
And
like the nice
George
guy.
George Clooney has kind of retired. Mm-hmm. He's kind of unofficially retired, you know?
They tried to do it with Mark Ruffalo.
It's not going to. He's not a big enough star.
No, he's not.
Not like how Tom Cruise was like the biggest star in the whole world.
They tried to
world.
Make Will Smith like the normal guy.
He tried to do it. Is,
yeah. I mean, Will had it for a couple years.
He had it.
He kind of had it, and then, you know, he just got too formulaic. And
then his wife ruined him.
And then his wife ruined him, which, you know, I mean, it really says a lot. But I thought that it was, you know, the Scientology thing, which Tom Cruise is a Scientologist.
Will Smith was too.
Will Smith was, I guess, for a time, and it's supposedly
they all say that. Tom Cruise is the only one that really says it with his chest.
He says it with his chest.
Everybody else says, I did it for a second.
Travolta still says it with his chest.
He still says it with his chest.
He still will say like that. I wouldn't.
That's because they got some gay shit on them.
They got some gay shit on them. Because they do this thing called auditing.
Yeah,
Deep Dark Secrets is supposedly what they did to Nicole Kidman, is that they audited her like crazy, and then like gave that information to Tom, and then he was like, oh shit, or whatever, and then he divorced her. So like they like literally will come between couples, kids, the whole nine. Like I'm surprised he actually still has a relationship with the kids that he had with her, because I don't think he still has a relationship with Katie Holmes and that kid.
You know, it's kind of like the adult version of like frat house culture, right? You know, like we're going to sit down and the brothers are going to paddle you, and we're all going to sit in a circle and you're going to tell us your deep, dark secrets. And then we'll all know, we'll all have something on each other.
Yeah.
And then therefore that makes us a bond. No one can leave.
It starts that way, except for the paddling part, because they do.
They doing something in there.
They
doing something.
Well, I know what they are, but the thing is that it only happens to certain kinds of people that get close to certain people. But it's still like there does seem to be some abusive shit. But the thing is that Tom Cruise does not get any of that. Because he is
the
celebrity.
He brings in people.
He's the biggest movie star in the world.
Yes.
And he's the head of a religion.
Well, there was a time where Tom Cruise now is like very protected. He's like, he doesn't do very in-depth interviews. Like he doesn't do any type of, and like honestly, everything that he says,
ever since the Oprah thing, he has not done.
Well, no, I mean, there was more that I've watched. All these fucking interviews. Where he's just like trying to fight with people. Like he's just trying to fight with people and argue with them. Because
he was being clear. He was like trying to explain to people like how psychiatry was the devil.
Yes.
You know, people trying to help you in that way is the devil. Or something.
Well, no, the psychiatry and putting kids on drugs, you know, like early on and things of that nature. He says, you know, that's wrong. But he also got this like weird award. Because he had a strange award that he got from Scientology because they wanted to make him the public face in like 2004, 2005.
Right.
And so they did this award and he had to do an interview for it. And I feel like that we should remember this because it's just him trying to explain what Scientologists do over and over.
Right.
And it's
call it Tom Cruise on Tom Cruise Scientologist.
This is a strange Scientology video where we're checking out.
I think it's a privilege to call yourself a Scientologist, and it's something that you have to earn.
Turn up a little bit for your boy.
And because a Scientologist does, he or she has the ability to create new and better realities and improve conditions. Being a Scientologist, you look at someone and you know absolutely that you can help them. So for me, it really
that
is KSW, and it's just
help
like...
Help them do what, though?
It's something that...
I guess get poor?
lose your money.
Yeah, lose all your money.
Give us $30,000, please.
You know,
we'll start talking about it.
That LRH does, but that policy to me has really gone...
I like how they do the Mission Impossible when he's in the back.
Yeah.
When I read it, I... You know,
go to where that spike is. Maybe that's a lot of...
And the more you know as a Scientologist, you don't become overwhelmed by it. And I went, you know, they said, so, like, have you met an SP?
It's at the top level. Scientology.
Yeah, the top level.
I looked at them, you know, and I thought, oh, what a beautiful thing, because maybe one day it'll be like that. You know what I'm saying? Maybe one day it will be that. Wow, SPs, like, they'll just read about those in the history books, you know? The thing is, I just go through
gibberish.
That second.
Wow. Yeah, this is like 9 minutes
from an SP.
Of him
some
just...
Some jibber-jabber from Tom Cruise.
I wish that... I wish that I could hear the questions from the interviewer. Because, like, you don't see any of that. Because the interviewer could just be like,
so what's your...
I think this is a video that's for Scientologists.
To get you hype on being a Scientologist.
And it's cut up, you know, in a way for us to watch it right now. This was probably a stolen video. You know,
this was a stolen video because they used it as part of the award.
Is that the Scientologist emblem or something?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Dianetics. Okay. That's the Dianetics. L. Ron Hubbard invented that. Because you have to create your own cross. If you look at it closely, it looks like a really old cross, but upside down. You know, you know those crosses that had the two lines, one shorter and one longer? It looks like that upside down.
It's like
a
Christmas
tree. And then they added the triangles to it, you know? So it's like a fake medical symbol, you know?
Yeah.
I know.
So this right here, like, I'm obsessed with cults, you know, and checking them out.
Yeah.
And like this thing he's doing right now, you can turn this off. This thing that he's doing right now is a very cult-like thing in which you know, bring the listener into you. And you're like, really? If you really want to understand what I'm saying, you like, you got to open your mind.
Yes.
You got to just open your mind, you know? And it's he hasn't said a
anything.
Coherent sentence.
He doesn't
say
anything. He doesn't say anything in the whole video.
And like, nothing.
Honestly, he just gets more aggressively preachy about it because he's just like, are you going to do it?
Because he's preachy. But it's like as
do
if
it.
the subject matter is a mystery. But he's just telling you how bad you need it.
Yeah.
But you have to do all these steps to find out what it even is. I can't even explain what it is to
no.
You couldn't comprehend. You couldn't,
your mind would explode. I have to give you tiny bits of it. You can't just become an SP. SP? They're going to be reading, like, you know, gibberish.
History books.
Yeah.
SPs?
It's just total gibberish, you know. Very cult-like. I was watching one of the Nexium cult things had a series of sashes they passed out colors. Very karate belt style. Mm. You know, they
love to accessorize.
They love to accessorize, and it makes sense they give you something when you pass a level. Because that's like a human thing, right? Getting a little coin or getting a little belt or getting
a little
whatever.
Little prize.
So, like, you know, I remember as a kid being so, like, a teacher could get you to do anything for some dumb sticker.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, so you're
getting, I
don't even you're
want
get a sticker.
Sticker but,
I do now. Everyone
but,
else is getting one.
But if that.
Yeah. So people,
I need a sticker.
So that's what this is like an adult version of that. You know, it's like this is the most famous man in the world, and he is so passionate about this.
Yeah. He should be too.
I need to find out why he's so happy. I'm so sad. They said they can turn all my bad feelings into good ones. Yeah. You know?
Oh, really?
So, yeah. It's such
deep
a,
cold talk.
Yeah. It's so weird. But you know what? Congrats to Tom Cruise.
Hey man, this movie, I'm hype on it.
Yeah, it actually looks
really
good.
The preview looked amazing. He made them all. He like put everybody's life in danger because that's how he rolls.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they built some sort of wild version of a fighter jet that actors could be in, and they had to kind of learn how to fly for real in their own way. There's like this whole camera plane setup. Nuts. If you watch the behind the scenes of it, it's actually nuts. Yeah.
I thought it was interesting because, you know, he refused to put it on streaming. He wanted it to be a big movie.
He waited almost 2 years.
3 years.
3 years?
It was ready. This was ready in 2019 to drop.
That makes sense because some of the main actor guys, they were hot back then and aren't now.
Right.
I can't think the guy who's playing the son.
John Hamm.
Well, John Hamm and the guy that's playing the son of Goose. Of the guy that I can't remember that actor's name.
Never trusting you.
I'm never gonna
make that mistake.
Right? Yeah. It's definitely a couple years back, but you know what? It's like the
dude from Insecure.
Yeah. I can't remember his name. He. I feel like that this is still like right on time, and the way it, like, he built it up by dropping trailers over the last through few years. I think it honestly really built up a good kind of energy for it.
It did, and he didn't put out. He didn't put out many projects in between when he started talking about this,
right?
And it happening.
He was doing little projects here and there, but like
what was coming out though? Nothing was really coming out onto in a big movie.
I think he had like done a Jack Reacher or something like right before that or something. Because he had done a couple more though,
Jack Reacher 2 or something.
Yeah, like it was a Jack Reacher 2.
Jack Reacher, and it's like almost if it's he wanted to just do Mission Impossible, he's like, well, I'll get somebody else paid.
Yeah,
so we'll just do Jack Reacher. It's the same shit.
I think it's the only thing that I miss from him is that I do like it when he had like a really nice variety of movies.
Yeah,
like
I'm a fan.
I like the Interview with Vampire shit. I liked
Interview with
McGuire.
Vampire is a horrible movie.
I liked it.
Not
though.
A good movie.
But you liked
I
it
liked
though?
It. I liked it though. I thought I liked The Firm.
The Firm was kind of bad. I liked it too.
That
I liked
was,
it.
That was kind of
it's
that
too
was
long.
I like the book, so I like the book. I like the John Grisham book.
You're a Grisham guy.
I'm a Grisham guy.
A Grisham man.
He's Virginia.
Hey, feel you.
Seville.
I was a big fan of Collateral, when Tom Cruise is a hitman that's old, trying to end his career, and then Jamie Foxx is the cab driver.
Yeah.
That movie is off the chain.
That movie was cool. He's got some dope shit, and then he just kind of went strictly action for like 10, 15 years.
Good for him.
And, you know, that's cool. I mean, he that's just wants to risk his life. Man.
Yeah, get out of here. Get that Vanilla Sky stuff out of here. Get that.
I saw that in the theater.
I did too. I saw that. I saw both of those movies in the theater. Get that.
I must have been. I think it was a date.
It's fine.
It was a date movie.
That movie's too long, too.
Facts.
Both of them.
Facts.
We want to hit up some more actor stuff.
Yeah, let's go to some more actor, music, whatever type shit. Johnny Depp, he got out of Dodge, got out of VA. And made it to London.
He knew he had 24 hours to respond to Steven Seagal shredding like that on the internet.
This is a direct response to Steven Seagal murdering it. And he's like, yo, I got to go out and play Jeff Beck.
Crystal Castle here.
You know Marc Maron salty. Marc Maron is like, yo, you got Johnny Depp up there playing with Jeff Beck. I can play way better than Johnny Depp.
I don't know if he's a Beck guy.
You know he is. He's a guitar guy.
You got to be a certain kind of guy to like Beck, because I don't even like Beck like that.
You don't like his guitar playing?
Nah.
Or Beck?
I don't care for them.
I do not care for Jeff Beck.
I love Jeff Beck.
I like his guitar playing.
I'm not crazy about it.
So this is, for some reason, he's playing with Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp
is friends with everybody, bro.
Everybody likes Johnny Depp.
With all the rock stars.
This is them doing What's going on?
Oh, man. Oh, no, this is not what I expected at all.
Oh, shit, he's playing rhythm on it?
He's playing rhythm guitar. Nope. That wasn't the right chord, Johnny. He got the A section down.
That's like 1-4.
If you're wondering, Johnny Depp is the guy going ding, 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 in the background. That drummer looks exactly like the librarian I had in middle school.
Well, she might be.
She looks just like her.
Might be her.
Man, is that her? Is that Miss Allison?
Miss Allison.
She's not kind of good.
Yeah, drummer sounded great.
Yeah, drum sounded good.
That's Rhonda Smith on bass.
Oh, she played with Prince.
Played with Prince. Amazing, amazing player. I mean, listen.
Johnny sounds fine. He's not taking a solo.
He might be taking a solo somewhere.
No, he's singing.
Oh, he's singing right here. Oh, shit. Little Wing.
Johnny Depp kind of looks like the white Rick James right now.
He does.
He got a Cocker Spaniel, blonde, curly wig hair thing going on. And he's got like a Kangol hat on sideways. Big
with a bandana. You know who wore hats like that? Who's the comedian that used to yell all the time?
Watermelon Smasher.
No, not the watermelon.
Sam Kinison.
Oh. Yeah. Wah,
wah, wah. What's the name? What's the wear that hat too?
Gallagher.
Gallagher wore one of those hats too.
He definitely looks like Gallagher right now. He literally looks like Gallagher playing guitar.
He's not taking
Jeff
a solo.
Beck.
This is Jeff Beck.
Yeah, Jeff Beck's the one. But, you know, John Depp singing.
Talk about butts in the seats, man.
Yeah.
I wonder if he just needs some bread, and he was like, yo, man, come play Lundy.
Johnny Depp just did this for fun, man.
Yeah. He did it as a goof, kind
of. He was just happy to be out of the courtroom.
Facts.
He's like, I'm going to go get a drink
tonight. He played two nights in London with him. Yeah.
He left the country immediately. He went to the airport in Richmond and went straight to London.
Facts.
Facts.
Or he took a PJ.
You're right. He took the PJ.
You know he took the PJ from Nova.
Yep.
Good for him. Look, sounded fine to me. He might be really good.
All right, so he passes today.
He passes, you know why? Because he doesn't pretend. Steven Seagal, this is his problem.
Oh, man.
He's up here pretending. He's playing lead. He's singing, taking all the solos, and playing as if he's amazing. And he knows that. I'm sorry. He knows that he's not.
Yeah.
Damn.
He knows.
I mean.
He already knows.
Ask Van Damme.
He knows. All right. Let's stick to some live footage.
Boston Colin.
Yeah, Boston Calling.
This festival had the crazy headline, the double headline switch, because the first, it was going to be the Foo Fighters, and then Taylor Hawkins passed, so they quit, and then it was supposed to be the Strokes, and then they all got COVID the day before or something.
The whole band.
Yeah, the whole band did. And so it'd be replaced. They were replaced by Nine Inch Nails.
Oh, wow.
So I was like,
Got better. Honestly, I mean, if they all have had strokes.
Oh.
All right, so yeah, anyway,
I could tell you that was about to happen.
Yeah, I knew something. He was
too quiet for too long.
But Metallica, I think they were already booked for a couple years ago for sure. Kirk Hammett is starting Nothing Else Matters, and things go left.
No way.
What?
Forgot it. He forgot it. That's a good way of doing it. He just fell down. He's just laying on his back.
That's actually kind of fast, though.
He's like, I've been playing this song for 30 years.
Sorry, you guys are so kick-ass. I got distracted by how kick-ass. Wait, we'll try that again, okay?
Yeah.
That's funny shit. Lars is like, what the fuck, man?
Yeah, he wouldn't be cool about it. He forgot this shit. Remember it?
Tune the guitar. Tune that motherfucker.
Yeah!
He really needs to tune that guitar.
He can't remember. You can tell already.
No, that's what he just looks like now.
Now you hear James Hetfield coming in.
He came in. No, he's like, come on, let's go play it.
Yo, James Hetfield's looking at him. He's like, you got it?
He's like, we're not starting this shit over.
Yeah. He's like, you got it, though?
I'll play with you.
He's like, the click track is rolling right now. Click track is rolling. You better get this shit right. Lars ain't stopping.
Lars ain't stopping. You know Lars is going to come in. Hey, I don't give a fuck what's going on over there.
Lars is like,
this coming right on the
go. He counts you off in Danish, and you go fucking go, motherfucker. Right now.
Oh, man.
That Explorer is pretty tight.
That's pretty cool. It's a custom-made one you got. All right.
Yeah.
That was actually charming.
That was very...
Yeah, it was fine. Bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was cool. All right, and let's see. Do we have one more...
Food news, the Mexican pizza is supposedly back. So, you know, I heard about that.
Oh, really?
The Mexican pizza was taken off the menu and it is now back. So go ahead and holler at that.
Holler at that Mex.
Holler at
that Mex pizza, yo. Okay. Pink Floyd joined TikTok.
Pink Floyd.
I saw that.
Which one? Who joined TikTok?
Dave Gilmore and Nick Mason.
Okay, you gotta pick. Tell me which side of the band joined. You know they aren't
the nice.
Roger Waters has to go by Roger Waters. He has to go. He's not allowed to go by. He lost. He tried to sue David Gilmore for the name, and they lost. He lost.
I don't think I knew that that's what he was suing him for.
Yeah,
I thought they were suing each other for like just for being pissed.
No, years ago. When they split up in '83, and then Roger Waters put out another record, and then David Gilmore was like, "We should put out a Pink Floyd album," and Roger Waters was like, "You can't do that shit. I'm not in the band."
Then he played at a wall.
He what?
Then he go play at a wall.
He's been playing at a wall for like 35 years.
He was like, "I'm gonna play." The wall at the wall.
Yeah.
At y'all.
Yeah, yeah.
He
was like competing. Yeah. They used to compete in the same fucking like towns and shit.
Having shows on the same night.
Yeah. Yeah, like during, Drinks. They were touring.
Making the fans choose.
Yeah. Yeah, and they were both, and he was playing the smallest spots. He was playing the smallest spots because he didn't do that well until he started milking the Pink Floyd shit. He was trying to do solo records for a few years. People were like, nah, bro. He's like, all right. So he's like,
hell no.
Bang, bang, I'll put this wall up again. Bang, 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 but
yeah, he was.
Yeah. But so David, he tried to sue him, and they're like, nah, man, David Gilmour's been in the band just as long, almost just as long as you've been, and has like written the songs, blah, blah, blah. You can't take the name, blah, blah, blah. And he was like so pissed. Mm-mm. So yeah, Now they're on TikTok. This is what he was trying to stop.
I don't see, you know, what are they doing on TikTok?
They're just playing clips just, of just concerts.
Hanging around.
That's all it is. It's just pictures. I don't mind clips this. Of concerts.
Yeah, I don't care.
That's
bro,
all.
David Gilmour is probably going to do some funny TikToks. Well, I'm not going to lie.
Look, man, if you pull up a video of David Gilmour dancing on TikTok, then I'll watch that.
I'm going to
I definitely will watch that.
I'm going to look. I'm going to look.
He's
and
not.
See.
They're not doing that. It's
no,
old
I already looked at no, it.
Oh, you looked? It's just clips of them.
It's just clips of them playing.
Is David Gilmour flossing?
Yo, that'd be hilarious. No, I look. Yeah, I would love to see David Gilmour's closet.
Just like one of those
black shirts.
Really complicated TikTok dances. Yeah. Have you seen people doing them as you drive? You should pay
as
attention.
You drive?
Pay attention nowadays when you're driving and you look off to people on the sidewalk. You'll see people doing TikTok dances, like with like maybe their phones on the ground or like on a sign or something. But you'll see people like doing like some doing dances on the road now. It's the thing.
I don't like that.
You see people on the road doing things and they turn around, they go like this and their clothes change. You see that too?
Yeah, you see people doing all this.
I don't like
the
that.
The glow up.
Yeah. The glow up.
I'm glowing up. I've been yassified. James, how come you don't want to get yassified? Come on now. Yassified. We got yassified. We thickified.
Ooh. Have you seen this... Monique
that's
beefing
sauce?
With D.L. Hughley?
I don't know anything about this.
Oh, fuck Monique.
Wow.
Leave D.L. Hughley alone.
Leave poor D.L. alone. Yeah.
Leave D.L. alone.
I'm sure he was being nice. He was being a nice guy. I don't know what the thing is with Monique. Like, maybe this is, like, one generation above our heads or something. Because I don't really know what this fight is about with her.
And the
industry.
Yeah, what's the...
Oh, well, no.
Oh, and she got mad at Netflix?
She just got mad that she didn't get as much money as she deserved. And then that boiled over to...
She's been fighting being blacklisted. She felt that she had been blacklisted by
Why
the top...
Why did she think that?
Because she spoke out against what she felt like was unfair treatment. She thought was unfair treatment for, like, the Precious movie. She says that she feels that you should be paid for... All the promo and everything that all the traveling, everything that you have to do, the festival circuit, all the big circuits, you have to go to all that stuff. And supposedly, I guess you don't get paid for that. And I guess that's what she was saying.
She didn't make any money. I mean, it's doing promo is not part of your contract when you do a blockbuster movie.
I think
don't
you
make blockbuster movie money for?
She was brand new.
I've seen Halle Berry sitting in one of those rooms just answering the same dumb questions over and over again. Like
she was brand new
person.
To that industry, to the big movie industry at that time.
Okay.
And she did not understand that. I literally had listened to a conversation with her and Kevin Hart where he's actually said, you could put that in your contract. You could put this in your contract. You could do that. He was literally saying this in the interview, which was interesting. So, I think she's been getting help with that. So she had beef with that and saying that was causing waves for her to not work in the industry.
Right.
That was happening.
Well, but the way she approached it, though, she blew it up really big.
It was bad. It was bad. But
it was hard for her to dial it back after that.
But now everybody has come back around. She has figured out because of Kevin Hart's thing too.
Okay.
Kevin Hart took her on his team.
He fixed her paperwork.
He fixed her paperwork because then there's
for a while everybody was treating her like she actually was the person in Precious. You know, like she's actually that mean.
They were people. Yeah,
I didn't know what
happened. People were like, they were very mad at her.
But Lee Daniels came out on stage at one of her shows and said, you know, that he was hiring her for one of his a couple of his movies and da da da. So they've made up.
Okay.
You know,
because I remember here when she was on The Breakfast Club, she had a lot to say about Lee Daniels.
Yeah, because it was still not.
That's his movie.
He wasn't saying anything about it, and she was like, she felt like she was being the only vocal person. I mean, listen, she was standing out there on that ledge by herself, and it was, and the approach was brash. But I think over those, I mean, literally, it's been 12 years since Precious.
Right.
So, the beef has been going on for a long time. Now, I think what she's been doing
overcooked beef.
Is, the people that did not support her through that are going to get the wrath.
That's what's happening.
Vindication. And I think D.L. Hughley, supposedly, she claims that he was threatening to pull out of a performance if she headlined. So that's what the deal is. And so she called him out on stage. It's a whole thing. And they've been posting on their Instagrams all day today. It's been a lot. It's really interesting.
That sounds like a bunch of comedian.
It's
like,
rich. It's rich black people.
This is rich people shit.
It's rich black people.
Because the idea that her and D.L. Hughley had a show booked, to me, sounds fake already.
And the show,
when did he said okay to the show and then pulled out because the promoter said she was going to headline? No, that didn't happen.
They've been posting these posts all day. I'm telling you, they've been going back and forth.
They're trying to get the clout. This is some kids. How the kids are doing it.
And the show looks clout. Horrible. Like it looks terrible. To me, it looked just like a black ass stage with her on it.
You
like,
mean the stand up show?
The actual stand up show.
It wasn't
show.
A TV show. It was just a live show.
It's just a live ass show. No, it's just a live.
But
show.
It being not looking like a TV show to me is fine if it's just a performance.
It's just a performance.
Just
performance.
Walked out there to do a comedy show.
Yeah, it's pretty raw. It's raw. Whatever.
Well, I hope she gets I guess she gets justice.
Yeah.
I mean, I still don't quite understand. It just sounds justice like they don't like each other.
Yeah. 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 No,
like, I should have been paid for my promo work.
That movie where I made all the money.
Yeah, it's just like
that wasn't enough.
It's just that weird after the fact thing that you didn't really have to say out loud. I think that she just felt like that she was getting fucked over, and it's because she really didn't have good management, probably proper management.
Well, she doesn't.
And
wasn't her husband her manager?
I think that's the other thing.
And he didn't know anything about shit.
Yeah, he became like
he doesn't know shit about shit. Kevin Hart solved 80% of her problems in one sit-down.
He became the cuck, for real. I mean, if you want to get into it. I mean,
who should have just called up Kevin Hart in the first place?
Yeah, yeah, but Kevin...
Just asked for some advice.
How about some help?
Well, I mean, honestly, the thing was, she was calling people out. I mean, that was the problem, and I think people had issues with that, and then they came back to her side once they saw that she's felt the brunt, and also she has made some money and has gotten out of whatever she was having issues with at that time.
Damn. So I mean, because I can believe that she had to deal with more bullshit than everybody else. I can believe that.
Yeah.
But this whole thing, especially to a group of people who don't even know what she's talking about, we're just all you'd see is her wilding out.
Yeah.
You know, so we're just like, oh, okay.
Yeah. I
hope she figures it out. Thoughts and prayers.
Thoughts and prayers.
Yeah.
I think she's figured it out. Okay. One more thing, and then we'll do mad big ups. Justin Timberlake says bye, bye, bye. To what? Entire song catalog.
He sold it for 100 mil.
100 mil.
Good
the
for
whole
him.
Five albums.
Good for him.
It's five albums.
I mean, what the fuck?
What
is that, 20 million an album?
It's like 20 million an album, and and that doesn't really include what's the name? Can't Stop the Feeling, which I feel like
that was from a movie soundtrack.
That's from the movie soundtrack. That song
plays
everywhere.
His whole catalog up to what point?
I think it's the whole. I think it's his albums and anything he's written on. Okay. It's all of that.
Okay.
I just feel like that's a low number.
Really? I don't, man. You know what? This is so theoretical. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we talked about this before.
Right.
It's
the
like,
idea that you had a cat. Let's say these books right here. Somebody wanted to buy them. $400 million.
Mm-hmm.
I guess you could say, "Holy shit! If somebody wants to sell them wants $100 million, maybe I could find somebody that wants it for $200 million."
Yeah,
but that don't. I mean, they offered you $100 million.
Yeah,
but maybe they offered him much less, and he negotiated it up to $100 million. But like,
we don't know.
This is definitely a thing that we should keep our eyes on. I do not know what's happening with this, but whatever this thing is with people buying up these catalogs is a big deal.
Yes.
I do not know what they're doing, but
I feel like
this is a big deal. Something is happening.
I feel like that
they're about to end music.
I think these musicians are
cashing out because they see the future of it. It's like, how are you going to make other than getting placement in
playlists?
No. Shit. Like commercial placement.
Yeah, that's
like
what I'm
that
saying.
Kind
movies.
Of, yeah, that kind of yeah. stuff. I think it's interesting, but I think those couple of years, definitely the pandemic. I think really seemed to wake people up to the fact that this shit is not promised.
That's right. The idea that, because it's kind of the musician dream, right?
Cash out.
Or this idea that somehow your catalog is worth some crazy amount of money. Mm-hmm. And I'm not just going to fucking give it up. You know, I know this shit is worth a lot. And then someone shows up with a bag of money.
If you own it.
If you own it, yeah. First of all. Someone shows up with the bags of money, and everyone's like, ownership, ownership, ownership. We all preach ownership. And they go like, I've been owning these five records. I've been owning these records for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I have not made $100 million.
So well,
I was like, this is an easy math.
It's a no-brainer.
Yeah, because that's true. I would say he seems to
make more records. He's not Bob Dylan. You know, he's not so old that he can't drop
another
hit. Yeah, he's not retired. Like a lot of these acts we talked about were kind of retired. You know what I mean?
If he's not going to do movies anymore,
doing movies. He's still acting.
Justin Timberlake?
Yeah, he was just in that Hulu series, Candy,
which is awesome, by the way. Right. Yeah. Everyone watches it.
Yeah, that's good.
I've heard that's really good. Okay, all right.
He's still out here, because whenever he wants, he can host the Tonight Show and SNL.
You think he can have another hit, though? Like, yes. Can't Stop the Feeling, if it's not attached to a movie?
Can't Stop the Feeling, in my opinion, was a horrible song. That's for kids.
I never want to hear some adult That bridge saved it.
Like, that song is like, it's like Happy. It's a great song. I don't want to hear it no more.
Okay. That bridge and Happy both had a couple things going for it, and that saved the whole thing.
Both songs that I don't want to hear ever again. But not because they're terrible, just terrible to me.
Mm.
It's for kids. It's for a kids movie. It feels like something from a kids movie.
Children's stuff. All I
need to do is dance. You know, whatever. But, you know, he's definitely going to have, I mean, they show videos of him hanging out with Timbaland and what's his name? Pharrell. He's back at it. You know, and don't forget Man in the Woods, it just didn't pop. He put Man it out, it just didn't pop. He's putting out albums. You know, he had that one song, people gonna say it's fake. People gonna say it's fake. You're just like, what?
What song was that?
That was on Man in the Woods. He was like, the music video, there's like a robot dancing around.
Oh, it's Supply Guys?
He's trying to be like Steve Jobs.
It was a song he had called Supply Eyes.
I don't know what that is.
I don't know about that.
Supply Eyes.
I don't know about that.
That was like the first single.
Well, that was rough.
It was weird. It was really. Remember, because the Super Bowl. Remember, he had the Super Bowl performance, and that was weird.
I mean, if there was like no other star is allowed to be as oversaturated as him. They love this dude. He's white. He's blonde. He's got the right vibe. You know, he kind of hangs out with black people. He's like, you know what I mean? They just like will let him be on every TV show at every awards show.
They'll let him show up to Saturday Night Live whenever he wants. He's got
the Super Bowl.
He's got the like the Steve Martin
kind of thing.
He's almost like Stevie Wonder. Like Stevie Wonder could drop off anywhere, any type of award show, any performance, and they'll let him do it.
You just let me know when JT's on another Steven Seagal album.
He needs to go ahead and make that happen. All right, well, good for you, JT.
Way to go, man.
Let's do Mad Big Ups. RIP to Alan White, legendary drummer. This cat has been on the road for, I want to say, 50 years at least. You know, he really came into the picture on Instant Karma, John Lennon, 1970. One of the first singles John Lennon put out, when people didn't even know. I'm not even sure if they knew that the Beatles had broken up by that time. So, and that's a revolutionary song. I mean, just those drum solos and the drum fills in Instant Karma alone. You make you legendary right there. He was the legend. He was the longtime drummer for Yes. And I mean, he stayed in that band for a long time. He also did a lot of other session work. He was on All Things Must Pass. He was on, a bunch of other cats.
He's got the double on the whole mix.
Yeah, man.
slap on the whole thing.
Yeah. I mean, he's one of my favorite drummers. He's one of the most tasteful cats. He was like a really awesome, sensitive rock drummer, but he could really play progressive.
Yeah, he played all the prog rock stuff.
Yeah, he crushed that shit.
Yes, so
amazing. He's not on Roundabout. That is Bill Bruford, but his version when he played with Yes, I love that version as well of Roundabout. The way he would play it, he just seemed like a dope dude. I saw that he definitely had a lot of health issues in like previous years, but literally he would get better and get right on the road. I think he was sick right before they got inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and he did not look that great. But he was right there. He was His timing was probably like a little, but he was there. He crushed it, and he's stayed on the road the whole time. And he was just that dude, man. He just sounds like he was a cool cat, you know. But Alan White, 72,
mad big ups.
I mean, genius. This cat. We got one more. Ronnie Hawkins. Rockabilly singer and mentor to the band. I mean, basically put the band together.
Yeah, I saw that.
The band before the band. The played Hawks. The Hawks. That's right. Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks. And then they played with Dylan, and then the rest was history. And, you know, this cat never really, I don't think he ever really had that bitter taste. He had, like, I think he had a couple more hits actually later on. But he never really had that bitter feeling. He seemed like he always was cool with those cats, even after they split and left the band and went to on bigger, brighter things. So, Ronnie Hawkins. this cat was also legendary rock and roll. I mean, really was playing out in the clubs, 50s, 60s.
Mm-hmm.
He was there.
Slap, too. They slapping.
There's literal slaps on this.
Slap. Slap back on the whole mix.
Slap back.
Woo! Fat slap.
Fat back, slap back. What? Good Lord. Woo. Yeah. Ronnie Hawkins.
Mad big ups.
He still had a little bit of that, he sounded black.
A little Elvis in there.
It was in there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, one more here. I mean, definitely Alan White was really that sucked, man. But same day, Andy Fletcher, from the founder and keyboard player of Depeche Mode, 60 years old, passed away. Don't know the cause of death yet. They have not released that. They were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2020, I believe, the pandemic year, and you know, I love Depeche Mode. They are my favorite, like, of that kind of
goth new wave.
Yeah,
goth,
new wave.
Goth wave.
Yeah, new wave. Yeah,
it's
goth
like
new
light
wave.
Goth.
Yeah, like goth. Yeah.
I love this song. This was my jam for a second. I was bumping this joint.
Oh God, I love this song. I love the video.
I love the way the drums drop in. They don't drop into the chorus.
This whole album. This era is like one of my favorite eras because the chorus guitar sound and shit they were using on the records is really fly. Also these drums were used on a shit ton of records in the 90s.
Madonna had these drums.
All the dance people had these records, had these drums. Play Policy of Truth real quick. This, like, some of these drums were never harder, than this shit right here. They never really got back to this this shit right here. So tough, bro. You push it up a little bit.
Shut up, Reg. I got
you. Oh, yeah. This shit right here, I mean, this is like R&B drums.
This is definitely in the, like, Seal would have went off on this.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is like layering the drums and shit.
Yeah.
This is also Alan Wilder. He did a lot of the along with Flood on Violator. Andy Fletcher was instrumental in a lot of this stuff. You know, he was really like the vibe and the heartbeat, if you will.
I was gonna say he's the vibe.
The
he's
soul, the vibe. Of the band. You know, he played synth, did a lot of synth and stuff like that. But he really was not, like, really heavily involved with the songwriting. But he was a great utility player, and he was Martin Gore's best friend. Martin Gore is a songwriter in Depeche Mode.
He was obviously the guy that was like, come on, y'all, let's have practice.
Let's, like, yeah, he's that guy.
You know, he's
that
guy.
He was that guy.
Because he is the co-founder.
If he was not, you know? If he wasn't playing something on the record, he's just dancing in the studio. He's dancing in the studio, and they're like, yo, like, Andy's dancing, like, we're on the right wave. But you know, yeah, this is just really, really sad because it would just be just two of the original members from Depeche Mode, and I hope they still come back and do another record, and, you know, do it in the memory. You know, maybe they'll bring Alan Wilder back or something. But You know, that mad big ups.
Mad big ups.
Mad big ups.
All right. Slaps up next. Fat back. Slap back.
Wait, can
bitch.
We do one more? Did we do? Hold on before. Hold on.
Cut the, yo.
This is unprecedented hustle season moment.
Whoa. All right.
Did we forget one? Did we do?
Did we actually do? We didn't do Ray Liotta.
Ray Liotta.
I knew I was forgetting one. Okay. Yes.
Save the day once again.
Woo! Once again.
Once again.
Relax. Once again. All right.
Ray Liotta, the ledge. One of the actors that was like, I'm a guy's guy, but I'm an actor.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of actors. Of course, in Goodfellas and any number of movies that you can think of, he's Mr. New Jersey.
Yeah.
He was like, I am from New Jersey. I am New Jersey. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And everybody is the greatest.
Yeah, we have a great character actor. I mean, consistent, ton of movies. I mean, like, the list goes on and on. I don't have him in front of me right now, but was he in Field of Dreams or something like that?
He was in Field of Dreams.
Yeah, like, yes. he's in legendary shit. So, yeah, we have to give mad big ups to Ray Liotta for sure.
I mean, we're talking Goodfellas. He was even in the B movie? I didn't even know he was in
B movie is actually not
Field
that
of Dreams, Blow, Hannibal, Killing Them Softly. I mean,
that's Hannibal.
So
that's
many,
right, yes.
So many movies. You know, No Escape.
Copland
with Sly Stone.
Woo! Yeah,
Fat Sly.
John Q, when he breaks into the hospital to save his son. Remember that one?
Yeah.
Oh, man. There's so many movies.
Classics.
A bajillion movies. Anyway.
Classics.
Mad big ups.
Mad big ups.